set.
Bendito, bendito. A Dios, los ángeles cantan y alaban a Dios. Yo creo, Jesús mío, que estás en el altar. Adorar, oculto en la hostia, te vengo. Bendito, bendito. A Dios, los ángeles cantan a Dios. Espero, Jesús mío, en tu suma bondad. Bendito, bendito. Cantan y alaban a Dios. Los ángeles cantan y alaban a Dios. Bendito, bendito, bendito sea Dios. Los ángeles cantan y alaban a Dios. Los ángeles cantan y alaban a Dios.
Bien. Bendito. We're talking about hymns, singing about hymns, the Bendito song. He was just a pretty little, beautiful little fluffy puppy. He didn't have a name yet, and the kids were all singing Bendito, Bendito, and he started singing with them. He just threw his little head back and started howling. So we said, well, that's his name. He likes that song. We'll name him Bendito. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the great love of God, and the hearty of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. You read this guy, it's coming out of a different culture and everything, but that's what it is about, hearty, happy hospitality. It'll be interesting to look into it a little bit. And this Mass, we remember, we thank God we're here, and we remember those who are not here for any reason, but especially those who've gone to heaven. In this Mass, we remember especially Estela Cavazos on the third anniversary already of her death, Diana Montes Flores, Chris Briones, Aurora Ureste, Melissa Flores Lozano, Ramon Guerra Jr., Roberto Rodriguez, Pat Cadena Guerrero, third anniversary of her death, and Lisa Garza, beautiful Lisa, who we just buried her a week ago. Remember her. So as we prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries, this sacred Sunday in the neighborhood, we recognize the spirit of his hospitality calling us through all the pages and all the chapters of the story of our lives. He calls us. He calls us to the feast of life, to live and to laugh and to love. Not always easy, but through it all, he calls us. It is you, Lord, who called us into being. You gave us this amazing gift of life through the life and the love of our mamas and daddies and grandmamas and granddaddies. Señor, ten piedad. It is you, Lord, who teach us to love life, to love you, to love each other. You call us to the banquet, and you provide the banquet for us through and with and in the family of the home and the family of the church, the people who love us and the people we love. Cristo, ten piedad. And it is you, Lord, who bring us to the fullness of life and love with you at the great banquet on the mysterious other shore, where many of our loved ones who we miss ferociously are smiling down on us. Señor, ten piedad. Que Señor Todopoderoso tenga misericordia de nosotros, perdone nuestros pecados y nos lleve a la vida eterna. Oremos. Almighty, ever-living, ever-loving God, we pray for our friends and neighbors and family members who are ill, especially those who are ill with the coronavirus. Send your healing spirit to them. Comfort all of us who are mourning. Give solace to those who are alone and afraid. Protect those doctors and nurses who care for the sick, and invigorate those doctors and nurses who are working on a vaccine. Help us to encourage each other in these trying times. In your great love and mercy, send your spirit to us to invigorate our souls by way of our fears. We could say take away our fears, but that don't work. The only way to take away your fears is to get drunk on Jose Cuervo, and I don't even know if that really works. So energize us by way of our fears. Eliminate this scourge so that we may give you praise and continue to build up your kingdom through Christ our Lord. Amen.
First reading, a reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will provide for all peoples a feast of rich food and choice wines, juicy rich food and pure choice wines. On this mountain, he will destroy the veil that veils all peoples, the web that is woven over all nations. He will destroy death forever. The Lord God will wipe away the tears from every face. The reproach of his people he will remove. From the whole earth, for the Lord has spoken. On that day it will be said, "Behold our God, to whom we look to save us. This is the Lord for whom we looked. Let us rejoice and be glad that he has saved us. For the hand of the Lord will rest on this mountain." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Responsorial Psalm. I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. In the house of the Lord all the days of my life. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. In verdant pastures he gives me repose. Beside restful waters he leads me. He refreshes my soul. I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. He guides me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil, for you are at my side with your rod and your staff that give me courage. I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. You spread the table before me in the sight of my foes. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for years to come. I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
Segunda lectura, lectura de la carta del apóstol San Pablo a los filipenses. Hermanos, yo sé lo que es vivir en pobreza y también lo que es tener sobra. Estoy acostumbrando a todo, lo mismo a comer bien que a pasar hambre, lo mismo de la abundancia que le da escasez. todo lo puedo unir aquí a quien Él me da fuerza. Sin embargo, han hecho ustedes bien en socorrerme cuando me vi en dificultades. Mi Dios, por su parte, con su infinita riqueza, remediará con esplendidez todas las necesidades de ustedes por medio de Cristo Jesús. Gloria a Dios, nuestro Padre, por los siglos de los siglos. Amén. Mis hermanos y hermanas en Cristo, esta es la palabra de Dios. De pie.
Aleluya, aleluya, aleluya. Aleluya, aleluya.
Que el Padre de nuestro Señor Jesucristo ilumine nuestras mentes para que podamos comprender cuál es la esperanza que nos llama de su llamamiento.
Aleluya, aleluya, aleluya. Aleluya, aleluya.
The Lord be with you. Reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. Now you notice right away he's talking to the elders, scribes and Pharisees. Jesus, again, in reply, spoke to the chief priests and the elders of the people in parables. This is, in fact, it might be an interesting exercise. This is very similar to last week, but not the same. There's some interesting differences. One real big deal comes out of this one. It's like we're developing the call, developing the amazement at the Spirit at work. The kingdom of heaven may be likened to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son. He dispatched his servants to summon the invited guests to the feast, but they refused to come. A second time he sent other servants, saying, "Tell those invited, behold, I have prepared my banquet. My calves and fattened cattle are killed, and everything is ready. Come to the feast." Some and went away, one to his farm, another to his business. The rest laid hold of his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. Remember that happening last week, in the last week's parable. The king was enraged, and he sent his troops to destroy those murderers and burn their city. Then he said to his servants, "The feast is ready, but those who were invited were not worthy to come. Go out, therefore, into the main roads and invite to the feast whomever you find." The servants went out into the streets and gathered all they found, bad and good alike, and the hall was filled with guests. Now you notice this last little part is in a, that you notice that they have it in parentheses. I think maybe the professor said, well, that's not part of the main thought, that's not part of the main message, but it's interesting, especially for Aggies. We'll look at it anyway, it's worth mentioning. But when the king came in to meet the guest, he saw a man there not dressed in a wedding garment. The king said to him, "My friend, how is it that you came in here without a wedding garment?" But he was reduced to silence. Then the king said to his attendants, "Bind and cast him into the darkness outside, where there will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Many are invited, but few are chosen." The Gospel of the Lord.
So the last part, the whole story can leave you scratching your head a little bit, because it's from a culture that's very different from ours. And even that last part is actually, it clashes with our culture now more than it would have, say, when I was a freshman at A&M. That is, the man comes into the wedding feast. That's the last part. We'll just look at that real quick there. So he comes into the wedding feast, but he's not dressed in a wedding garment. That is, he's not responding to the hospitality of the king in a respectful way. In our culture now, especially now, we say, well, we don't make a big deal about clothes. Clothes don't make the man. And that is true, but there's something about it. And I can remember when I was at A&M, our professor telling us, when you're out teaching, even if I come to see you when you're out in the pig pen doing something with the pigs, I want to see you wearing your necktie. And I want you to shine your shoes and comb your hair and brush your teeth. That is, there is that. And I've had that as a priest, having seminarians come. You know, a lot of times seminarians just come for a short visit, and then we had her out for a year, and before we had other seminarians come in for a year to kind of get the feel of the parish. And that was one of the things I remember having a kind of a clash, saying, look, when you're on duty, you wear your Roman collar, you brush your teeth, you comb your hair, and you shine your shoes. When you're on duty, it's the way you respect the people who you serve that way. You don't dress like a slob when you're on duty. And I remember one of the guys said, well, you just say that because you're an Aggie. Aggies are always shining their shoes and pressing their pants and combing their hair and trying to be neat and spiffy. And this particular good guy, really good guy, just, you know, young guys have to spar with the old guys. That's just how it is. But I remember he told me he went and talked to one of the older priests, was kind of his counselor. And he complained. He says, well, Father Roy's trying to make me dress up. He says, I have to shine my shoes and I have to wear my Roman collar. Well, he's being mean to me. He's picking on me. And the older priest told him, you do what he tells you. There is something there. You wouldn't want to overstate the case. You wouldn't want to say those who don't dress for the occasion or show respect by the way they are dressed are despicable or unworthy. Yeah, we wouldn't want to say that, especially now our culture is much more laid back. I can remember when I was growing up, we would go to Grandma's house on the Sunday before Thanksgiving. That's when the whole tribe would get together. And all of the ladies would dress up, and I can remember smelling the turkey and the perfume and the cigarettes. A bunch of them smoked cigarettes in those days. And the men, even if they were working, like even if they were line men for the county, they would dress up to come to Grandma's house. They'd wear their suit and tie, and it was an occasion, and they honored the occasion. They responded to the hospitality by dressing up. It was a symbol of respect, a symbol of taking. It was a symbol of taking this occasion as a sacred occasion. You know, so it does mean something. We wouldn't want to overdo it, and I suppose that's why. They put it in parentheses there. That's not the main thing. The main thing is hospitality. But the point would be there that he was not impressed with or responding enthusiastically to the hospitality of the king by not wearing his garment. I don't know why they had to tie him up and throw him out and into the darkness where there was wailing and gnashing of teeth. Have you ever gone to one of those restaurants where people have to dress up? I remember going to the Shamrock Inn in Houston when we were kids with Mom and Dad, and I can't remember what it was. I think Mom was wearing slacks or shorts, I guess your Bermuda shorts, you know, like up to her knees. And they said, you have to wear a dress when you come in here. And Mom said, well, I didn't know that. I didn't wear a dress. They said, well, here, we have one for you. And they would hand you just kind of a little wraparound dress. And if the men didn't have a necktie, they'd give them a necktie. That was in the 50s. I bet they don't do that anymore. But there's something to that. It's worth taking into account. But that's not the main message. The main message, if you remember last week, the owner of the vineyard, the farmer, hires these men to work in the vineyard, and they reject their responsibility, and they reject him. They get so full of themselves that they throw his son out and kill him. That's, of course, Christ is talking to the scribes and Pharisees who are rejecting him. And then on a deeper, broader, wider, higher way, he's talking about the call of God to us to be responsible to Him, to accept His authority and to respond to Him in a faithful way. To be faithful to Him is to be true to ourselves, and not to be faithful to Him is to destroy ourselves. That was last week. This week there's a new, kind of a new element, you could say. The new element is this: celebrating life. My son is getting married. He's going to start a new family. This is a sign that God has not given up on us. Every time a man and a woman fall in love and start a new family, and then especially when we start baptizing those babies, God's still at work in the story of our lives. He still loves us. He still comes to us. He still sends us His Spirit. Life is still overcoming death. The life force, the love force, is still shining down on us. The king invites them to the banquet of his son's wedding. And you notice there's some, and then you could kind of look at that, some just say, well, I don't know, I got to go feed the cows, I got to go work on the farm, I got to go check the books and my business. And then, so there are those who just say kind of, I don't know, I don't think I'm going to go. And then there's those who are hostile. Now, what's the deal with that? He sends his servants. He says, come to the feast. Come to the banquet of life. Come celebrate life and love with me. I'm not going to charge you anything. Just come. I've got all kind of good food, all kind of blessings to share with you. Come to the feast. And they get pissed off and kill the servants. What's the deal with that? Well, of course, it's symbolic of the scribes and Pharisees who cannot stand Jesus. He just drives them nuts. You know, his goodness, his sincerity, his authenticity just riles them. He's disturbing them in their hypocrisy. You know? And he has this sense of the beauty of life that somehow or another bugs them. And so he's kind of like he's disturbing their attachment to ugliness, however you want to say, something going on there. But it's more than that. Of course, it does mean that. Of course, he's talking to scribes and Pharisees who will kill him. But it's you say, what does that have to do with us? It has everything to do with us. God calls us to the feast of life. He calls us to the banquet of life. He gives us life. And he gives us love. And he blesses us in all kind of ways. There are all kind of signs of his beautiful, hearty, happy hospitality to us. And he invites us and expects us to respond. He's to be amazed and grateful, to be joyful, to come to the feast. I remember, probably not many of you all remember, do anybody remember Bishop Fitzpatrick? He ordained me 40 years ago, me and Father Eddie and Father Raul. A bunch of us were in that class of 80 from Oblate College. But I remember one time we did this exercise with him. He asked all the pastors to write to him what their hopes and dreams were for their flock as they work. Just tell me about your parish and what you're working on, what you hope and what you're worried about. And so we all wrote pages and pages, and then he wrote, Here's what I pray for and dream of. And I remember one thing he said: I pray for and dream that all the faithful of the valley will come to the table of the Lord, not because they have to, because they're afraid it might be a mortal sin if they don't show up, and not because they're afraid they're going to get in trouble, that they might not get confirmed or might not get first communion if they don't show up, that they'd come because they're delighted to be invited to the feast, that they're so amazed and grateful at the gift of life that they want to come and worship the Lord who gives us life, that they want to be with the family of God who lifts up their hearts to the Lord. And it was, I wish I could find a copy of it. It was very beautiful the way he wrote it. I never knew that until he started writing all that stuff. He had a good way with words, but that's what the gospel is talking to us about, that God invites us. Even in the midst of the pandemic, in the midst of maybe even more, in the midst of heartache, in the midst of fear and worry and pain and mourning, he says, the life force is always stronger than death. The life force, the love force is outshines, eclipses, surpasses. The love force actually it's fertilized, it's liberated, it's invigorated through the grief of death. There was this I don't know if you saw 60 Minutes, I think it was 3 weeks ago. Lalomita and Father Roy and Bendito were on it. They interviewed us for about 2 hours, and we were on there for about maybe 20 seconds. They had a shot of Father Roy walking out of Lalomita with Bendito, and then they had a... A lot of times when they do that, they'll quote the dumbest thing you said in the time they talked to you. But no, this time they had a pretty little short quote from me, real brief. But in that same 60-minute program, they had a story about David Attenborough. It's an unusual name. I've never heard it before. But he's a British, 93, 94-year-old British naturalist. And he was just talking about his love of the beauty of nature, his love of life, his love of the creation. And he was talking about how that you're invited to the banquet of life. This is, I'm kind of paraphrasing, by way of nature. A lot of the Psalms are that way. If you read the Psalms, there's 50 of them. But among them, there are a lot of the Psalms are saying, the world you have created for me, the world I'm created in, is such a sign of your love for me. It's so beautiful, so wonderful. It lifts up my heart. It's such a feast, the world you give me. And it reminds me of your hospitality. It's a sign of, or an offering of your hospitality, your love for me. We often, on the senior retreat, we go over that quite a bit. I don't know if I ever get through or not. There's a 75-year-old priest talking to 17-year-old people. I don't know. Well, we probably get through a little bit. But he was, but in the, I tried to, Maddie tried to find it on the computer, but we didn't quite find out. There's this one line where he said, even in a time when we're beaten down by sadness and death, even more, the sound of a bird singing reminds us of the beauty of creation, reminds us of God calling us to the feast of life. Beautiful, beautiful kind of an expression of, there's all kind of signs. So when Jesus tells us the story about the hospitable king who gets rejected, it's much more than just about coming to Mass. Of course, coming to Mass is part of the deal. It's part of the deal. But the deal is, like St. Eugene always said to the early oblates, you know, if you're preaching the gospel and there's no connection between the table of the Lord and the table of the home, then you hadn't quite got it preached yet. That we go back to the table of the home and we celebrate life. That God is with us, the God we worship, the God who feeds us with the bread of life at the table of the Lord, comes to us now when we're here at home. He's blessing us through each other. He's inviting us to this beautiful banquet of life, blessing our hearts through each other. We've had so many, you know, we have so many funerals just in the last few months, well, probably 6 months now. If you've been with me at funerals, I almost always do, you know, we bless the body with holy water, reminds us of our baptism in Christ who takes us to heaven at the end of the journey. And then we bless the body with the incense. And we say, of course, this incense is a symbol of our love and prayers going to heaven with the beautiful soul of this person who died. But then we always remember to say this connection between the story of our lives, between the table of the Lord and the table of the home. Incense, and we'll be using plenty of it in a little while, reminds us of a lot of good times around the barbecue pit. Good times. I can remember the way Mom and Dad used to cook this barbecue chicken. I'm talking about, gee whiz, 70 years ago. I can almost taste that barbecue chicken. I think one of the things that made it so good was that they used a lot of bacon grease. Oh, it was good. But anyway, the incense reminds us of so many good times around the barbecue pit, the table of the home, around the kitchen stove, when we were nourished by delicious food. Boy, nobody could cook like they could. But even more, we were nourished by the Spirit of his hospitality, the Spirit of his love coming to us through each other. And even now, you say, well, I miss those times. I miss that barbecue chicken that Mom and Dad used to make. I can even see Dad standing there with his boot up on this big rock around the barbecue pit saying, we've been blessed. We've been blessed. We're so blessed. And he said, Grandma and Grandpa are still alive. Little did we know, but he knew, of course, there are things to come that are going to break our hearts. But right now, our hearts are blessed. Well, that's the banquet of life. We're invited to celebrate. So I thought of several songs about that. I better quit talking. One song was, you've got to be old enough to remember this one. Life is a cabaret. Life is a cabaret, my friend. Come to the cabaret. Old song. Another song was, I want to live, laugh, and love. While I'm here, I want to live and laugh and love. That goes with the catechism. Who made me? God made me. Why did God make me? To know Him, to love Him, to serve Him, to be happy with Him, to come to the banquet of life. Then the one I finally landed on anyway was, Meanwhile Back at Mama's. And there's this one line repeated in the song, sweet, the words are in your bulletin, but this one line, it's funny the things you miss in a world gone as crazy as this. Well, in the story of your life, in the story of your life, you can discover God's hospitality, God's invitation to you to celebrate the banquet of life with Him and with each other.
New truck, bank lets me borrow from month to month. Running out of credit, and find a little cash on the radio. Standing still, they're blowing past. Numbers on cars going NASCAR fast. What I wouldn't give for a slow down, don't you know? 'Cause where I come from, only the horses run. When the day is done, we take it easy. Meanwhile, back at Mama's, the porch light's on, come on in if you wanna. Supper's on the stove and beer's in the fridge. Red sun sinking out low on the ridge. Game's on the tube and Daddy smokes cigarettes. Where's Ski? He keeps his whistle wet. Funny the things you thought you'd never miss in a world gone crazy as this.
Make so much smoke that we can't even find it.
Found a girl and we don't fit in here. Talk about how hard it is to breathe here. Even with the windows down, can't catch a southern breeze here. One of these days, gonna pack it up and leave here. 'Cause meanwhile, back to Mama's, the porch light's on, come on in if you wanna. Supper's on the stove and beer's in the fridge. Red sun sinking out along the ridge. Game's on the tube and Daddy smokes cigarettes. Whiskey keeps his whistle with. Funny the things you thought you never miss. In a world gone crazy as these. The for sale sign's gone up and I'm gonna dump this truck and the little I got on a loan to own and a 3-acre lot. With supper on the stove, beer in the fridge. Going for broke, yeah, we're gonna be rich. Watch the sun setting on the ridge. Baby, tell me what you think about this. Me and you back at Mama. Yeah, me and you.
in you, back at Mama's. That hospitality lives in your heart, calls you to the feast. Let us pray, my brothers and sisters, that our hospitality and our response to the amazing hospitality, mysterious and marvelous hospitality of God to us with this holy sacrifice will be acceptable to God, our loving Father. Lord God and loving Father, your love and hospitality illuminates and guides all the moments and memories of our lives. Hear the prayers and accept the gifts we offer for our sick brothers and sisters. Restore them to health and turn our anxiety for them into joy. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, all-powerful and ever-living God, it is right and just, and we do well always and everywhere to give you thanks. It is in you we live and move and have our being. Every day you are showing us signs of your hospitality, signs of our Father's love, all kinds of signs. Your Holy Spirit dwelling, working, calling within us, gives us here on earth the hope of unending joy. Your gift of the Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead is the foretaste and promise of the great Paschal feast in heaven. With thankful praise and the company of all the angels and saints and all of our loved ones who are with you now, we glorify the wonders of your love.
Santo, 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 santo es el Dios del universo, llenos está el Señor, hosanna el cielo, bendito el que viene en el nombre, hosanna en el cielo.
These gifts to make them holy so that our bread and wine may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Before he was given up to death, the death he freely accepted, he took bread and gave you thanks and praise. He broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body which will be given up for you." When supper was ended, he took the chalice. Again, he gave you thanks and praise, gave the chalice to his friends and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant. It will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
anunciamos tu muerte, Señor.
Resurrection, his ascension into heaven, and his Spirit inviting us to the feast now. We offer you, Lord, our hearts. With this bread of life and chalice of salvation, we thank you for inviting us to the feast, to stand in your presence, to seek and to serve you. May all of us who share in the body and blood of Christ be brought together in unity by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, our family, your church, spread throughout the world. Help us grow in love. Together with Francis, our Pope, Daniel, our Bishop, and Mario, his assistant, and all who care for our family, remember all of our friends and loved ones who have been taken away from us by the angel of death, especially those we are remembering more tenderly and missing more fiercely as we come to your table now, and all those who've died in your love. Bring them into the light of your presence at the great banquet of the family in heaven. Have mercy on all of us. Make us worthy to share eternal life with Mary, the Virgin Mother of Christ, with Saint Joseph, her husband, with the blessed apostles, and with all the saints who've done your will throughout the ages. May we praise you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ. Por Cristo, con él y en él, a ti Dios Padre omnipotente, en la unidad del Espíritu Santo, todo honor y toda gloria, por los siglos de los siglos. Amén, amén, amén. Amén, 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 amén. United by the hospitality of Christ and faithful to his love and his teaching as it has come to us, from mom and dad and grandma and grandpa, and as we pass it on to our children and grandchildren, we pray together in those good words that come echoing down through the centuries to us in the family of the home and in the family of the church from the heart of Christ himself.
Padre nuestro que estás en el cielo, santificado sea tu nombre, venga tu reino, hágase su voluntad en la tierra como en el cielo. Danos hoy nuestro pan de cada día, perdona nuestras ofensas, como también nosotros a los que nos ofenden. No nos dejes caer en tentación, y líbranos.
Deliver us, Lord, from the hostile forces of evil. Graciously grant us peace and that sense of wonder and gratitude in our days. In your great love and mercy, keep us free from the darkness and disintegration of sin. Protect us from all apathy, cynicism, and arrogance as we continue the great quest, seeking in joyful hope the way, the truth, and the life of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Don't look at our sins. Look at our hearts. Wounded and worried and weary hearts, but all the more sincere and faithful. Look at our faith. The faith of Mary and Joseph. The faith of the apostles. The faith of our family. Your church. And grant us the peace and the unity of your kingdom where you live forever and ever. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Cordero, Cordero. Que quitas el pecado del mundo. Ten piedad de nosotros, de nosotros, de nosotros, ten piedad. Cordero, Cordero, tú que quitas el pecado del mundo, danos, danos la paz. Danos, danos la paz.
Well, those mariachis are fired up today, aren't they? I think Juan drank 2 cups of coffee this morning or something. Really good. This is Jesus Christ, the bread of our lives, the vigor of the hospitality, the hearty hospitality of God coming to us in Christ, who rose from the dead and sends us his Spirit. Happy are we who are called to seek him and to come to the banquet, to cooperate with that Spirit of his love. Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring us all to everlasting life. Got a little extra ritual here now in the time of the pandemic. I'll say the prayer after my communion, and then the last part of the Mass will be all of us come into the banquet to share the bread of life. You can read all the announcements. The only one particular you might want to take note, Father Phil, you may have noticed he'd been getting kind of worn out lately, so he decided to take off a little bit of extended time. I don't know how much time, but he's going to take off a little time to recharge his battery. So he'll for sure be gone a few weeks, but he's doing fine. He's not sick. He's just, as my daddy used to say, he's pert near, but not plumb wore out. So just pray with him and for him, and we'll be glad to see him when he gets back. Let us pray. God, our loving Father, you call us to the banquet, not in spite of, but by way of our human weakness. You notice in the gospel there, he called everybody, good and bad alike. Like Pope Francis says, it's not a country club for the elite. It's a field hospital for everybody who's wounded, which is all of us. Show to our sick brothers and sisters the power of your loving care. in your great kindness, make them well and restore them to the family of the church and to the family of the home. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. God has called us out of the darkness to the banquet of his wonderful light. May we experience his hospitality, his kindness, his blessings, and may we be strong and hearty and happy in faith, in hope, and in love. Amen. Because we are called to the banquet, we are seekers and followers of Christ, who appeared as a light stronger than hostility and death. May he make us reflections of that light for all those we share this journey with. Amen. May the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon our hearts and our lungs and remain with us forever. Amen. Our Mass is ended. Let us come to the table of the Lord, to the banquet of the Lord, to share the bread of life. Thanks to all of you, and have a beautiful Sunday afternoon.
Desde que voy junto a ti, la tierra que yo piso es como espuma. Desde que voy junto a ti, la noche más oscura tiene luz. Yo pienso que la vida no está, pues todo en realidad me lo das tú. Andando de tu mano, qué fácil es la vida. Andando de tu mano, el mundo es ideal. Andando de tu mano, qué fácil es la vida. Andando de tu mano, el mundo es ideal, Señor. Desde que voy junto a ti, mis ojos se han abierto por completo. Desde que voy junto a ti, mi vida nunca ha vuelto a ser igual. Tú eres la antorcha, contigo quiero ir hasta el final. Andando de tu mano, qué fácil es la vida. Andando de tu mano, el mundo es ideal. Andando de tu mano, qué fácil es la vida. Andando de tu mano, el mundo es ideal, Señor. Desde que voy junto a ti, la tierra que yo piso es como espuma. Desde que voy junto a ti, la noche más oscura tiene luz. Yo pienso que la vida no es tan dura, pues todo en realidad me lo das tú. Andando de tu mano, qué fácil es la vida. Andando, el mundo es ideal. Andando, qué fácil es la vida. Andando de tu mano, el mundo es ideal, Señor. Desde que voy junto a ti, mis ojos se han abierto por completo. desde que voy junto a ti. Mi vida nunca ha vuelto a ser igual. Tú eres la antorcha. Contigo quiero ir hasta el final, andando de tu mano. Qué fácil es la vida, andando de tu mano. El mundo es ideal, andando de tu mano. Qué fácil es la vida, andando de tu mano. El mundo es ideal, Señor.